Now, go on to chapter 42 and look at verse 5. Isaiah 42, verse 5. Here's the second element of God's verification through his prophetic signature. He says, secondly, only trust the book from the God that prophecy describes. So what he says is, the God who tells the future, along the way as he's telling the future, describes himself. Trust the book from the God that's described in prophecy. What do I mean by that? Look at verse 5 of Isaiah 42. Thus says the Lord, thus says God the Lord, who created the heavens and stretched them out, who spread forth the earth and that which comes from it, who gives breath to the people on it and spirit to those who walk in it. The first description of the God you can trust is, he's the creator. So remember, trust the book from the God who describes himself. And how does he describe himself? First of all, as creator. Now, I don't know where you are in your understanding and biblical study of creation, but there are some tremendous elements in this verse explaining how this universe got to where it is today. You notice what it says in verse 5? He created the heavens and stretched them out. The most frequent way God describes creation is a stretching, or literally using, remember, the something those people could understand. Those were a lot of shepherding, herdsmen people who lived out on the range with their animals, and they lived in tents, and they had to set up their tents, and so they would pack them up, move to new grazing ground, and they would take their tent and they would unroll it, and they would stretch it out. It would go from a compact to unrolled out and then made. God describes creation always in the Bible as a stretching out or an unrolling from one point outward from there. In fact, if you know how God describes creation, he describes the earth as the center of the universe. This is where his throne is poised over Mount Zion, over earth. His eyes behold us at all times. So God is here over the earth, and he is stretching out the heavens outward. So that's why the light of the most distant star from every one of them is already here. Because the light did not go from there to here. The light went as God threw and placed the stars in the galaxies and the clusters of galaxies. He spread them outward from the earth. That's how God describes creation. Did you know that either you can choose the way that people who don't believe in God and who rely on their own wisdom and observation, they never saw creation, but they're trying to, from the background effect of it, figure it out. Either you can trust them, or you can trust the one that did it and wrote down what he did. See, that's the first test. He said, are you going to trust the God who knows the future, who describes himself as creator, the one who unrolled the universe? Secondly, he's a sustainer. Look at verse 6. I, the Lord, have called you in righteousness and will hold your hand. I will keep you. What's he keeping us from? We'll zip down to verse 9. He says at the very end of this verse, the new things I declare before they spring forth, I tell you of them. He says, I'm the one that knows the future. I've already told you what's going to happen. So you need to, verse 6, you need to allow me to hold your hand and keep you and give you as a covenant and a light to the peoples around you. You see, he said, I'm the sustainer. I already know what's happening. I wrote down Psalm 139 every day of your life before you lived it. I knew everything you were going to face. I knew all of your struggles, your disabilities. I knew your diseases. I knew exactly when you're going to have kidney failure or respiratory failure, or you're going to contract cancer or some debilitating disease. I knew all of those things. Every day of your life, Psalm 139 says, was written in my book. And so since I already know the future, and since I'm the only God who's written down the future so that you can verify that I'm the real God, then I want to be your sustainer. Verse 6, I, the Lord, have called you in righteousness, Isaiah 42, 6, and will hold your hand. I mentioned last week that children have taught me so much, raising children. I guess I had a lot to learn because the Lord gave me a lot to raise. I had to keep learning it over and over again, you know, patience and endurance and sacrifice and, you know, learning to pay attention and not just going, and never hear what they say and all that stuff, you know, and still learning it. And I have a 9-year-old, my youngest, and usually she said about 4 or 5 words, and I go, wait a minute, I'm gonna listen to everything you say. Say that again. But the thing that they taught me that's so sweet is how much they love, when they're little, to hold your hand. Now, it starts before they're old enough to hold your hand. In fact, this is the first lesson I learned way back in California when I was at Grace Community Church and little Johnny was born, our first child. We lived in a space saver apartment. That's what they called them in Los Angeles. It cost a lot of money and it was small. That's called a step saver, I guess. That's what it was. In the LA Times, it said step saver apartment. And so we only had a little money, so we got a little apartment. And it was so little that when Bonnie and I were laying in bed, we could reach into the bassinet and pull Johnny out, change his diaper, and we could reach into the bathroom sink and set the diaper in the sink without leaving the bed. That is a step saver. In fact, I could stand in the middle and sweep the whole apartment like this from one pivot point. Like, you know, it was amazing. But Johnny's bassinet was right here, the only spot, and there was this little walkway, and we would just, you know how you pat him and feed him and get him asleep. One time, old Bigfoot here, you know, I have real wide feet, triple E's, I was coming along and I hit the foot of the bassinet, and the bassinet shook. And little John went just like this. You ever seen him? That's that reflex. There's some medical term for it. When a baby is sound asleep and you jar them, their arms go out like this. And you know, I was just positioned. I was looking down at him and it almost looked like he was trying to hug me. I thought that was the neatest thing. That when he was scared, he put his arms out to me. You know what I started doing when Bonnie wasn't looking? I'd kick that thing every time he got to sleep, and he'd do that again. I loved it. And when he got a little older, you know, and scary things would happen, he would grab me, or he'd reach up and hold my hand. Look back at this verse. God says, I've called you in righteousness. I know what's coming in the future. I know everything you're going to face, and I want to hold your hand, and I will keep you. He's the sustainer. So he's the creator, verse 5. He's the sustainer. Look at verse 7. He's the redeemer here. To open blind eyes, to bring out prisoners from the prison who sit in the darkness. Verse 8, I am the Lord. That's my name. My glory I'll give to not give to another, nor my praise to carved images. He says, I am the Redeemer. I am the one that took you in your blindness and took you in the prison house of your sin. I am your Redeemer. Trust the God who reveals himself in prophecy. Trust him as creator. Trust him as when your bassinet of life gets kicked and you reach out. Reach out to him, he says. I'm your sustainer. I'm your redeemer. Finally, verse 9, he says, I'm the revealer. I'm the one that's going to show you the future. Behold, the former things have come to pass. Everything I told you in the past, verse 9, all the promises and prophecies and predictions I made in the past, those you can trust, and new things that I declare before they spring forth, I tell you of them. Only trust the book from the God prophecy describes. Now, go to chapter 46, Isaiah 46, and verses 9 and 10. Thirdly, here's the third element of God's verification through the prophetic signature. He says this, only trust the book from the God that prophecy shows is reliable. Look at verse 10 at the very end, and I'm going to actually back up through this, because the end of verse 10 says he's reliable. It says, saying, my counsel shall stand and I will do all my pleasure. God says, my counsel will stand. What I've declared, my statutes, my judgments, my laws, my decrees, everything I prophesy, it's going to stand. I'm going to accomplish it. I'm reliable. Back up to the beginning of verse 10. God is accurate. The first part of the 10th verse says this, declaring the end from the beginning and from ancient times the things that are not yet done. God says, I tell you, accurately, the end from the beginning. He says, I in the beginning see all the way to the end, and I know, and I declare, and I describe, and I'm accurate. Every single prophecy that's ever yet so far up through 2008 been fulfilled has accurately, precisely, and exactly happened the way God said. I mean, in Ezekiel, there's a prophecy about how the city of Tyre, T-Y-R-E, was going to be destroyed. And it was so detailed. It says that in the destruction of this city, and by the way, Tyre at that time, the Phoenicians, they were the masters of maritime trade and industry. They were the mariners. They were amazing. And they had this citadel out on an island that was completely impervious to any attack because they had the best navy and they were out on the island. There was no artillery that could get out there to them. And they were just smugly sitting there, wealthy as you could be. And the Bible said those people were going to be destroyed, and it said that their city, even the dust of it, was going to be scraped up and dumped into the sea. And many tried, and no one succeeded till Alexander came. And Alexander the Great came, and he took and destroyed all of the coastal cities the Tyre inhabitants had, and he totally razed them, scraped them together, and made his soldiers carry the dust and dirt and rubble out, and they dumped it and made a causeway out to that island capital. And every word God said, down to the scraping the dust and pouring it in the water and making a causeway, that God had said hundreds of years prior, exactly happened. God says, trust me, I am accurate, I am reliable. Look at verse 9 as we're backing into to this passage. Remember the former things of old, for I am God and there is no other. I am God, there's none like me. He says, I'm unique. I'm the only God who is accurate about the future, who is reliable, who can be trusted. Now, go to chapter 48. We only have two more.